Hallo liebe Freunde der historischen Armbrust. In einem meiner letzten Videos über die Spannhilfen im Heiligen Römischen Reich kam immer wieder die Frage, warum kommt denn der Geißfuß nicht vor oder ich hätte den Geißfuß vergessen. Das hat genau zwei Gründe. Zum einen, weil der Geißfuß im Heiligen Römischen Reich grundsätzlich nicht verbreitet war. Und zum anderen, weil die Quellenlage so aussieht, dass der Geißfuß erst gegen Ende des 15. Jahrhunderts in den Quellen auftaucht. In der englischsprachigen Literatur wird der Geißfuß zwar immer wieder bereits in das 14. Jahrhundert gestellt, tatsächlich ist es aber so, dass die Bildquellen den Geißfuß nicht vor 1500 darstellen und diese Mechanik, dieses ausgeklügelte System des Geißfußes meines Erachtens nach überhaupt nicht ins 14. Jahrhundert passt.
In 14th century Europe, the crossbow developed, according to its regional allocation, into a Central European and a Southern or Western European type. This development was finally complete in the 15th century. The Central European crossbow stock of the late Gothic period is curved, thickens in the area of the nut and tapers to its rear end. It has either a spanning tooth for the belt and pulley spanning device on the top of the stock or a metal pin running through the stock as an anchorage for the rack or crenakin. This pin is located around 16 to 20 centimeters behind the nut and holds the rack in position during the spanning process. The Southern or Western European crossbow stock is very simple. It runs parallel from the bow to the nut, has a continuous bolt groove and has a rectangular cross-section. The support for the rack or crenakin is missing. It was not until the late 15th century that the trigger axis, which lies around 8 cm behind the nut axis, was extended and also served as a support for a new spanning device, the gaffle or nowadays, the goat's foot. If you now try to span a crossbow of the Central European type with the goat's foot, you will fail. The spanning device and the weapon simply do not fit together, as the necessary rest at the height of the trigger axis is missing. Similar situation with the crenakin, if a crossbow of the Southern or Western European type is missing the required rest, no spanning process is possible either. For the spanning process, the hooks of the goat's foot are placed in the bowstring from below, the two claws are set on the extended trigger axis and the T-shaped end piece on the lever arm is pushed against the thigh. Both arms grip the stock and pull it against the upper body until the bowstring snaps into the nut. But if the goat's foot or gaffle only appeared towards the end of the 15th century, how was the crossbow of the Southern or Western European type spanned? As in Central Europe, spanning belts, or rope and pulley spanning devices were used. The windlass, which appeared as early as 1400, was used for powerful bows. Another spanning device also appeared towards the end of the 15th century, the wooden spanning lever. Its use was largely limited to simple crossbows with a peg lock for target shooting. The spanning lever device was used in a sitting position. The shooter places the rear end of the stock on his thigh, positions the hook of the lever in its support at the front end of the stock and presses the bowstring into its bearing with both arms. In summary, it can be said that the crossbow and its spanning devices were subject to constant further development during the Middle Ages. Due to the use of crossbows with different design features, Regionally different spanning devices were also used at the beginning of the early modern period.